All right, so we're going to, today, we're going to be talking about diagnosing infections. And I looked at it and I went, why'd she put it, the author of the book, put it this early in the chapters? But then it sort of made sense when I got through reading about half the chapter. Diagnostics is not something you'll do a lot of, but you may have to interpret what the lab writes on a sheet of paper. So, from a nursing viewpoint, it does kind of help to know a little bit. Now, how do we identify bacteria? There are phenotypic characteristics. So that means we've got to grow them up and figure out what they do, what their morphology is, what their physiology is, what their biochemistry is. That is the old-fashioned way of doing it. We still have to use the old-fashioned way because we have to characterize each bacterium from a patient. But that's growing it up in culture, which may take 18 to 24 hours for most of the common disease-causing organisms. But if I'm pulling from a sore throat, I may have 50 different organisms on a plate. I've got to pick individual colonies and figure out which one's causing the disease. So that's the phenotypic characteristics. Immunological, serological analysis is great. It's kind of like the, it's using antibodies. It's kind of like the pee test. If you pee on a stick and you get a little positive, it's like, ooh, there's a baby coming. Okay. That's an immunological test. What they can do is for strep throats in a lot of doctor's offices, they have these little white cards, and you take a swab, and you swab the back of someone's throat, and you should realize that streps like to be at the back of the throat, so you almost have to get a gag reflex to get a good sample. If they don't get into the back of your throat, they're not going to catch the streps very well. But you get a good sample, and you just rub it across the screen that's on there, and you wait a couple of minutes. If it turns blue, it's positive. You've got strep. Doesn't tell you what species of strep because it's a general test, but it's a great way of quickly identifying what organisms may be present. Some of these serological tests can be really specific, but most of those are fairly expensive to run, and a general lab's not going to have them. But let's say I suspect you have Lyme disease. You've been camping out in the woods and got ticks all over you, so now you have Lyme disease. So we send a sample off to a reference laboratory, and it may take a day or two. Because what they do at the reference lab is it's going to cost them $600-$700 to run a plate, but they can run 96 samples on a plate. So they store your sample until they get enough to run a complete plate. So that's one of the reasons those reference laboratories are kind of slow getting started. Now, genotypic techniques, this is increasing because we can use real-time PCR to identify an organism in less than 30 minutes. We can not only identify the organism, but if the test is set up correctly, we can tell you whether or not it's resistant to different antibiotics. So they've got MRSA tests now that they can swab and run through this real-time PCR machine, and it will tell them two or three different antibiotics that it is either resistant or sensitive to. And that immediately gives the doctor useful information. It just gives you unusual profiles. It's easier to see on the screen, but my laser doesn't show up when I point it at the TV screen. So the phenotypic characteristics is the observational methods. What's the colony look like? And that's helpful because if I'm looking in a throat swab, I'm looking for those slimy colonies that are producing lots of capsule, lots of biofilm. Genomic, this is a DNA microarray, and you should always have a positive and a negative control on any DNA work that you do. If you start seeing lab work coming in and you don't see a positive and a negative on there, they're not doing their job right. Something's wrong. Because you can... Dr. Deborah had this problem one time. I had the problem. DNA contaminates everything in the room if you're working with it. so what we try to do is not have our positive controls in the same room where we process all of our samples. Because the positive control can get into the air, it can get on the pipette tips, and it will give you a false positive response. So you have to be very careful in how you do that. This is kind of a DNA fingerprinting method where they cut the DNA up with different restriction enzymes and they run it out and they're looking for similar patterns. Let's see. These proteins appear to be about the same size. These proteins appear to be about the same size. And that kind of helps. You know, immunological analysis, they've got agglutinins and they've been using the agglutination test for quite a while. That's how they used to do the time crossmatch. You do a finger stick, you put it in the three little wells, and you add antibodies, anti-serum, from each different blood type, A, B, and AB, in order to see if you get clumping. But you always want to use a blank as a negative control for that. And if it clumps up because of all the antibodies sticking to it, then it's an agglutination positive test. It's a quick way of identifying. So have any of you ever heard of the book called Outlander? Come on, some of the ladies in here had to have heard of Outlander. You have? They're romance novels. But this nurse from World War II era was sent back in time to the Highlands of Scotland. And she's trying to help people with none of the modern equipment that they've got. What if you need to give a blood transfusion? How are you going to tighten cross match? You could do it. You could take blood from several people, take the serum from it, and mix it with the blood from the patient that needs it. And if it clumps, don't use that. Use the one that doesn't clump because it's not got antibodies against it. But the Outlander, I was going to read it because of the medical stuff, but it's just too sappy for me. I can't. I'm sorry. Yeah. Can't handle that. All right. Preparation for survey of microbial diseases. Other techniques augment these diagnoses. What I can't stand is for doctors or veterinarians or dentists or anybody else to make a definitive statement without running any diagnostic tests. I'm sorry, call it a microbiology thing. The doctor goes in and he says, well, it's a strep infection. Wait a minute. You've not run a single test. You don't know it's strep. There's at least a half a dozen other diseases out there. If he said, it's probably strep because I've been seeing that go around, that's okay. When they make that definitive statement, it just gets on my nerves. You know, one of my pet peeves. All right, let's see. MRIs, they're great. PET scans, they're used to find areas of deep tissue infections. The magnetic resonance has really helped a lot. And I remember in high school playing with magnets, thinking, ooh, wonder if you could get, you know, what's going on between the two. But I didn't get the patent on it, somebody else did. All right, so light microscopy, cell shape, Gram reaction. You can do specialized stains in histology to tell the difference in them. You can do endospore staining. You can look for granules or capsules. When you stain for capsules, you don't stain the capsule itself. You stain the cell and the background, and what's clear is the capsule. So the thicker the capsule, the more dangerous the organism is typically. That's really primarily used for things like bacterial meningitis. All right. Electron microscopy. It's not used diagnostically very much. The CDC uses it for confirmation. Thing is it takes too long to prep samples for electron microscopy for it to be useful in a hospital situation. I don't know of a single hospital that has their really cool. I wish I had more time to get in there and play with it. You know, it's a really nice piece of equipment. But you can get some really cool pictures, really close up. But most of the time for diagnostics, it's not going to be something you need to do unless you're trying to study a specific organism. Traits. How fast does it grow? Does it grow in oxygen levels that are low, high, intermediate? Does it grow in gelatin media? You can go all through all those biochemical tests that we've been doing in the lab. Phenotypic characteristics still have to be done on every single sample that goes through the lab. It's very laborious, and it won't go away. Because even with rapid testing methods, you still have to isolate and save those samples for the CDC. If it's a reportable disease, samples have to be sent to the CDC. It made it a lot harder to ship those samples. So a lot of hospitals in this area will just drive their samples over. All right, let's see. Fermentations of sugars. So the pattern of sugars that they can ferment can tell you a lot about the organism. Production of gas, sensitivity to antibiotics, all of those things still need to be done separately. Because even a genetic test that tells you that it's sensitive to an antibiotic doesn't tell you to what degree it's sensitive. It just says plus or minus. So you still have to go in and grow it up and make sure that it's going to be effective diagnostically and clinically. Chemical analysis. They don't use it very much. Peptide composition of the cell wall. But now the membrane lipid profiles for about 5 different diseases, they use lipid membrane profiles. So most hospitals don't do this. Legionella pneumophila. You ever heard of Legionnaire's disease? It's really kind of cool. The guys with the funny looking hats that drive the go-karts during the Christmas parades. There were a bunch of them in the early 70s, 1970s, excuse me, that got sick with Legionnaire's disease, and it was in Philadelphia. Well, I'll tell the story when we get to it in the lecture. But now they can take those and look at their lipid profiles under very specific conditions and tell exactly what strain it belongs to. So it's a rapid way of really narrowing down how to treat the disease. Because all of them are really different. It seems like every strain of Legionnaires you get is really different. This is a real good way of doing it. But mostly reference labs at state levels are done. They have one in Montgomery that does these tests for all hospitals in the state. Genotypic, PCR was great. Real-time PCR is awesome. You know, rather than taking all day to set up and run it, real-time PCR, if you know what you're testing for, that's the trick. You've got to know what you're looking for. So if you're looking for MRSA off of a wound infection, done. I can do it in 30 minutes. But if I don't know what's causing the disease, then I don't know what primer sets to use for my PCR, and it's going to take me a while to figure that out. So you still have to go back and do some Gram staining, do some morphological testing, try to figure out what group you're looking at, so you can see where it can be that way. Now, genotypic methods are increasingly automated. They have some really cool robots. I wish I could get one for the lab. It grows it up on the plate. It brings the plate out of the incubator. It picks colonies. And it places them into wells, it isolates the DNA, and then it runs to real-time PCR. It's idiot-proof. I mean, you just need one tech to run it, and you're taking the jobs of all those med techs. You could have been doing that by hand. But you take some of the problems out of human error. But you also miss a lot of those. The new digital microscopes seem great. You don't need as many cytotechs out there. My wife's a cytotech. She quit working in cytotechnology because there are no jobs for her. digital microscopes to take them. But a digital microscope won't detect parasites in the blood because it's not looking for that. It's looking for something else. All right. Viable, non-culturable. There are a lot of microbes that can't be grown in the laboratory because we simply don't know how. Most of those are not pathogens. Vibrios can be viable but non-culturable, but they're culturable when they can cause infection. When do you get Vibrio vulnificus or Vibrio cholera? In the summer months when it's warmer. Don't eat raw oysters. Don't eat raw oysters. Don't eat raw oysters. But if you're going to, at least eat them in months where it's cold. Know where the oysters are coming from. And don't get oysters in Alabama. I know there's a couple of restaurants around here that sell raw oysters. God, how long were they on the truck to get here? Were they kept on ice? Maybe, but maybe not. So I'm worried about all the parasites and the hepatitis. And I posted a picture on my Facebook page the other day. It's two tanks of water from the same area, and they put oysters in one and they didn't in the other. The one with oysters in it was just as clear as it could be. The other one was muddy. They're filter feeders. It doesn't matter to them what they are. They just suck everything in. So all the garbage. You know what makes them grow? Organic matter. So fecal matter running into the bayou down near the Gulf of Mexico. Yep. Those are the big, fattest, best looking oysters. Because they've been eating crap all day long. Just remember that. Eat them cooked. Eat them cooked. I'm sorry. Hot sauce, horseradish, and alcohol does not kill the bacteria in the raw oysters. Not unless you let them soak in the vodka for like a month. So, I've had people, oh, I'm drinking enough alcohol to kill it. No, you're not. I had a friend once said, why don't you let me sneeze on a plate and I'll lick it off. Then you can lick it off. Just the same difference of eating a raw oyster. Just you're just eating junk that's on the mucus. Antibody response. These are really rapid methods, and they're great for narrowing down what the organism's going to look like. The strep test that you want to run in most rooms where you get the blue response is positive, it doesn't tell you whether it's Streptococcus pneumoniae, Pogenes, or whatever, but it gives you the general genus. So then you can go and do more testing. Specimen collection. This is where you guys come in. You're going to have to be able to collect specimens aseptically. So it's kind of like the aseptic technique that we've covered in the lab, where you're having to set up an aseptic field. You know, you can lay the surgical paper over the area and be real clean, and you just got to use common sense and think about it. If there's fecal material smeared across there, clean it off before you start. You know, use aseptic techniques as much as possible. I don't have to harp on the individual ones, but the more aseptic you can be, the better off the patient is. Treat those samples like they're gold. Don't leave some poor old person's blood in a hot car while you go into McDonald's, because I'm going to be pissed. Because you got to go back and stick that old person again or collect another sample. Do the samples first, then worry about eating. Okay. Use sterile sample containers, sterile tubes. Always be real careful of sharp objects, needles. Never try to recap a needle. And always put it in the sharps container. They're going to train you with all this in nursing school. And you're going to get yelled at every once in a while. Because you're tempted to try to recap sometimes. I'm tempted sometimes in the lab. It's just, you know, I can just put the cap on it and lay it right here. But no, just throw it away and get a new one. It's too easy to miss and stick yourself. And you don't want to take any chances with hepatitis or HIV or anything else. All right. Remember, a lot of samples, like if you take a sputum sample, it's got a lot of normal flora bacteria. Well, the longer you wait between the time you collect the sample and the time you get it to the lab, the more bacteria can grow and change. So I've got good bacteria and bad bacteria in this mixed sample. Sometimes the good bacteria in the sample can overgrow the bad bacteria and you can't diagnose anything. So if you wait 4 hours between taking the sample and getting it to the lab, it doesn't mean anything. If you let it get warm, keep it on ice, that slows everybody down so they don't grow so much. So, but now if you're taking a sample and you're walking down the hallway or riding in the elevator up one flight, okay, you don't have to keep it on ice necessarily. You're going straight to the lab to get it started. They'll put it on ice for you. But use some common sense if you've got a long way to go to collect these samples. A lot of you going into home health nursing need to be really careful. Carry a little, one of those collapsible coolers with you and keep some ice packs in there so you can maintain the integrity of your samples. Try not to touch the tongue, cheeks. You're not wanting to get dripping saliva off of it. You're wanting to get it at the back of the throat near the tonsils. So get that gag reflex going. Occasionally, saliva samples are needed for dental diagnosis. Or if you're looking for things, I guess it would be Streptococcus pneumonia, AE, you're looking for a rusty, mucousy phlegm that's coming up. But for the most part, you're really looking for back of the throat samples. Urine samples are normally fairly clean if you collect them the right way. Very few bacteria in urine unless you've got a bladder infection or UTI. But you got to do a clean catch. So you're going to be handing people a cup and sending them to the bathroom, and you're trusting them to do what you tell them to do. They won't. They don't listen. I had a man who was supposed to bring me a urine sample from first thing in the morning, and he brought me poop. And I swear he used a spatula to smooth the top off, and he brought me this cup full. I'm like, that was for urine? I don't need this. I don't know how he got, there wasn't an air bubble in the thing. He pressed it down in there. God, you're going to get those things. All right, so clean catch. You want midstream samples. There's a lot of bacteria on the surface of your private areas, men or women. Wash your hands before you start peeing, and then move it over into the cup. Or move the cup into the way, whichever way it works for you, I don't know. The clean catch method, you don't want to get that first voided urine because sometimes there'll be stuff right on the surface that will get washed into the cup. You can use applicator sticks. This is usually if it's someone that's been catheterized and they've got an infection and it's inflamed. Skin samples. There's lots of different ways of taking those. Most of the time the doctors will take the deep samples, but they may send you to do a skin scraping, especially if they are thinking that it's a fungal infection or something like that. And you can take the back side of the scalpel, not the sharp side, and scrape. Just scrape the skin and then wipe it off on your glass slide and cover it with a cover slip. You want to try to avoid any pustulating wounds or anything, so a lot of times you will not try to go into the deeper samples. That's usually the doctor. Let's show you how to do all this. Make sure everything you use is sterile, if at all possible. Specimens, eye, ear canal. A lot of times if you're doing ear canal, you're doing a lavage or a wash, so you're having to put drops in there and then kind of suck some of them out. If you've got someone that has the bullseye rash of Lyme's disease, I think I gave you Lyme's disease one of them. So you got a big bullseye rash on your back, one of those ticks ones. And that's where it's lighter, red, and raised a little bit, lighter, red, and raised. It looks just like a bullseye. Right in the middle where the tick bit you, there's usually little flaps of skin, so you can take a pair of sterile forceps, pull it up, and cut a little piece of that tissue off. Flap kit in the storage. Where are you going to get your samples? Sputum, swab the back of the throat, saliva, blood samples, that's probably the most common, always white. And, you know, I like to get someone who can take blood well. And there's some of you will just have a knack for it. I'm sorry, it has no relationship to your intelligence. Some of you just have, it's an art. Some of you get good at it, and everybody knows there's somebody on every floor. You're a nurse or you work in a hospital. There's somebody on every floor that when you got a real hard stick, you call Joe or Jane or whatever. And they can always get it. It's amazing. But it's just a knack, and some of you will get it and some won't. Clean urine catch, midstream samples, catheter catch. You can get a lot of contamination from the catheter itself, so expect the bacterial counts to be higher in catheter catches. Skin swabs, spinal taps, these are performed by doctors, and a lot of times they'll send you to the lab with the sample immediately afterwards for any kind of testing that's done. That's how quick they want that sample to get to the lab. That's fecal samples, try to use sterile techniques for collecting it. In other words, don't use a spatula to smooth off the top. That may not be sterile. Vaginal swabs or sticks. Skin scrapings. Yes, taking it off the foot. That's common because diabetic patients will frequently have ulcers or sores on their feet. And that's one place where you do collect a lot of those samples. Hold on. What was that at the bottom? Yeah, I like some of these. These are great. Because you can have a box of them, and if you're collecting a sample, there's a little glass vial in the bottom that contains media for preserving or taking care of the sample. You swab the area, you put the swab back in there, screw the cap on, and you break the glass, and that floods it so it's ready to go to the lab. And those are really handy, but I can't keep up with which ones they're using in the labs, and they all have brand names that are different than what I would know it as anyway. Oh, cool. So they're neutralizing the bacterial growth? Is that what it is? See, I didn't know that. It's been so long since I've done any of this stuff. We used to do drug screenings at the lab I worked at a lot. And you wouldn't believe what people will do to try to buy with drugs. I'm sorry. Catheterize themselves. Run urine from a bag. If they're wearing long sleeves in July, something, you know, roll your sleeves up for me. I had to go watch, you know. That was always kind of awkward. Putting Drano underneath their fingernails. And they flick the Drano into the urine and it changes the specific gravity, so they get a bad test back. It's just a bad test. So that gave them a few more days to try to drink all the water they can to flush it out. And one guy was having muscle cramps because he drank so much water for days trying to flush it all out. But he had washed all of his electrolytes out and he was getting muscle cramps in his legs. God, those stories are great. You just can't make those up. If you ever go for a government job interview and they're having to do that, they'll offer you coffee first thing. They fed me so much coffee when I went to work for a nuclear power plant one summer, and I was taking samples. I wasn't having to do a whole lot, but I had to go through the drug screen. And they fed me so much coffee, I'm like, I gotta go to the bathroom. Well, wait just a minute, we'll get you in. I'm like, you better. Come on, I'm ready to go now. I was scared. I had had poppy seed muffins, and I heard poppy seeds can give you a false for heroin. Okay, I've never done heroin in my life, but I told them I had eaten one. Okay, laboratory techniques. You learn this, and these forms change constantly. You're going to have lab supervisors that are great. they'll go through and train you on how to do them. Nowadays, they've got them set up in the computer, so they just tab and hit buttons, and they can fill out these reports pretty quickly. Always double-check yourself if you're having to fill one of these out, because it's too easy to get. It's like me putting in grades. I'm having to go back and forth and look at names and make sure I've got everything right. And I still make mistakes every now and then, so if you catch me, call me on it, I'll fix it. Serological test on patient sera can direct or indirect evidence primarily of specific pathogens. Let's say the skin test. I'm sorry? Yeah, TB test. Duh. What they do is they take antibodies of tuberculosis, not antibodies, antigens of tuberculosis. I call it essence of TB. They grow up tuberculosis. They filter out all the live cells, so it's got the waste products of tuberculosis in there. It won't make you sick. And then they inject that under your skin. If you've been exposed to TB in the past, you have antibodies against TB, so you get a big welt response. And you can measure it and tell whether or not, you know. It doesn't mean you currently have TB. It just means you've got antibodies against TB. So it's kind of an indirect measure. If you have patients that have come from other countries, India specifically, they give, what is it, BCG or BGC, I can't remember, it's a vaccine against tuberculosis they still give there. So anybody that's had the vaccine will show positive on the skin test. So they have to go in and do an x-ray to make sure there's no spots on the lungs to indicate problems. Some pathogens are identified solely on patient signs and symptoms. You're bleeding out of every orifice, I'm not saying Ebola. Chances of Ebola causing major problems in the U.S. is really slim. I'm really more worried about this enterovirus. That's probably what's causing this bronchitis to go around for everybody. There are enteroviruses, or there are several others that could. But the enterovirus is showing polio-like effects in some kids. Have you read that? You've heard of the children being paralyzed around the country? It's the enterovirus, and it's affected some kids for some reason. I don't know. I saw a lady on the news the other day. Her daughter got a flu shot, and a few days later, she was paralyzed. Well, I don't know if I'd blame it on the flu shot. It could have been an enterovirus, or it could have been a combination of the enterovirus plus the flu shot. But, you know, you take a chance every time you get a vaccine, but the vaccines overall, you know, 1 in 100 million or something can have a reaction to it. It's coming back. It's reacting just like polio.
So,
It does similar, yeah. Guillain-Barré is more of an autoimmune disease where the antibodies are going to be attacking the nerves and especially the neuromuscular junctions, where polio destroys the nerves, but then you can get new nerve growth. Nerves do regrow a little bit. They just don't grow much. One of the problems with trying to repair nerve damage is if you've got a stretch of nerve, it's kind of like a stretched rubber band. When you cut it, it retracts, and you get scar tissue formed between it, and it can't make that connection again. So a lot of people are trying to do things to break up that scar tissue in the middle, and eventually you do get some reformation. So if you can get to the patient early enough, they're trying that in a lot of the military soldiers that have spinal injuries. They're trying to block scar tissue formation early enough, and then they're seeing positive influence of regrowth of nerves. It's slow, and it may or may not work, but it's better than no chance at all. Okay. Start with patient analysis. You've got immunological and serological tests. You can do antibody titers. You're going to have titers done on you. Fat hepatitis,
shot, you've had antibody series. Three shots. Anybody that works in the hospital has to have it, or if you work for sewage treatment plants or certain places. They'll do three shots, and then they'll take some blood, and they're looking to see if you're titer, and the titer is the amount of antibody in your blood serum. If your titers are high enough, you don't have to go through another series. If your titers are not high enough, then you've got to go through another series of three shots in order to try to raise that titer up. My brother went through his third set of shots before his titer went up. And if it had not gone up, he would not have been able to work in the same part of the plant that he works in now. So he works his sewage treatment, water treatment plants, and that sort of thing. He drives tractors. So once you get the isolated organism, you can look at the Gram reaction, you can use fluorescent antibodies, you can do quick tests like the stick test for strep or whatever. You can use gene probes, PCR, then you can also use culture techniques. This has to be used every time anyway. These direct testings over here may or may not be used depending on what condition you're in. And then you get some presumptive data. You send the presumptive data to the doctor. Nowadays, they're getting it to their iPads. They know as soon as the lab puts it into the computer, it's updating into their database. So they can start changing the antibiotics that they're using, and then when confirmatory tests come in, they can finalize the treatment options for the patient. This is repeating itself a lot. You can use selective or differential media. You can purify your samples in multiple different ways. You do biochemical tests. You look for color changes. You look for growth in antibiotics. A lot of the blood auger plates that they use now in hospitals have already been embedded with different kinds of antibiotics. Most hospitals don't have to do like we do. We have to make our own media here because, well, the university's cheap. So it's cheaper for me to hire two undergraduates to work in the lab than it is to buy the media. Therefore, we have undergraduates making their media. So a lot of them, you embed the antibiotics, and you can use it as selective or differential. If I add an antibiotic and I grow it at higher temperatures, usually only your pathogens can survive in both those conditions. So if I raise it up to 39, 40 degrees Celsius to grow the plate, I've killed off a lot of the non-pathogens from the sample. So that can kind of help. You're not going to be doing a lot of this except when you're doing your unknowns in lab. You will look at all of these different reactions that are listed there. So you get your unknown. You streak it for isolation. You pick the isolated colony that you're going to identify. You streak it out. You know, make sure you've got a culture that you can go back to. You Gram stain it. You report those results, and then you start making decisions on the next step. But what you don't want to do is just grab every media in the refrigerator and run every test possible. You're wasting media, and a lab manager will chew you out. Trust me, if you waste media. I ran one test just because I was unsure of something, and I got chewed out once so bad. That lady was, she was something. And I'm like, it's a 50-cent test, but she's you're wasting supplies. So have a reason for running every test that you run in a lab, or doing something in the hospital. My opinion is, if you got a patient, do what's best for the patient. And if some manager starts yelling at you, you can at least live with that. You know, I couldn't live with the fact that I made somebody sick because I didn't want to throw out a glove and grab another one. It's just me. All right. I love some of these rapid tests. We don't use them in here because they're a little expensive. Usually they're about $5 a piece to run. What you would do is you take your microbe. Okay.
Sorry.
It's all right. God, she blushed. It's just you dropped things. At least you didn't fall out of your chair asleep. That would have been embarrassing. What you do is you put your bacteria in each one of these in a broth solution. You incubate it, cover. Some of them have, let's see, I can't remember which ones. Some of them you cover with a little oil to make them more anaerobic than other tests. There are instructions with it. You let it grow for 24 hours, and then you read them. So each one that's positive, you can take that number and bring it down here. 4144000, and then you search a database online, and it identifies what your organism is. We don't have those in the lab, but that's basically running all of the same kinds of biochemical tests that you would see in the lab. You're going to be running them separately, where this is running them all at one time. These are great rapid tests. They're not the end-all be-all. There's other things you can do. There are keys. We have books in the lab that will help you identify your organism. So if you want to look up in some of those keys, let's say E. coli, type B. So you look up E. coli, it will tell you exactly what the reactions are supposed to be for the organism. The problem is the bacteria don't always read the book. You may have some weird bacteria out there that just doesn't follow the rules. So now, you're going to be, hopefully, either today, I don't know if I'll be able to do it today, next week you're going to be getting your unknown for sure. What you're going to have to do is start making some decisions. So let's do a flow chart for various cocci. So you have a cocci, you look at it if it's gram positive or gram negative. If it's gram positive, you can do a catalase test on it. That's just putting hydrogen peroxide and seeing if it bubbles. Catalase test, you can determine whether it's in irregular shapes like staph, whether it's strep, whether it's clusters, tetrads, cuboidal, whatever. If it's catalase negative, you look at it, it's pairs, chain arrangements. So this is more than likely a streptococcus. Then you can go find, how do I differentiate the different kinds of strep? Oops. If you have a strictly aerobic, it's probably a micrococcus. And a lot of times micrococci are colored. There's Micrococcus roseus, the column is kind of a rosy color. Micrococcus luteus is bright yellow. So a lot of those are very pigmented organisms. You find them growing on the top part of leaves, where a lot of the ones that are white colonies will grow on the bottom side of the leaf because they can't stand sunlight. Staph, Planococcus, these are facultative anaerobes. Let's see. If you have gram negative, and there are very few gram negative cocci that cause problems. Neisseria, so gonorrhea, meningitis. There's a few listed there. So aerobic versus anaerobic, whether it's oxidase or catalase. So you have these reactions that can narrow it down. Usually you can look at the shape of Neisseria, and they look like two kidney beans stuck together, surrounded with a matrix of junk. That's Neisseria. If you have Neisseria and it's a vaginal or a penile infection, you know it. Yeah, you can squeeze on the penis, wearing gloves, of course, and pus will run out the end. It's not really pus, it's the Neisseria that's running out the end. And if you send a guy into a bathroom to take a urine sample and he screams, he may have, an STD. So you'll seek out medical attention. Phage typing, great,
way of doing it. They don't do it much here in the U.S. The Russian government uses phages. They have a cocktail of bacteriophages that you can drink in Russia that will kill off a lot of the diarrhea-causing diseases because it kills the bacteria, just the bacteria that cause the diseases. But they don't use that here in the U.S. very much. Basically, all it is each phage only kills one kind of bacteria. So you can take a plate, put whatever your unknown bacteria is on there, and make a lawn where it's completely covered. And then you drop all of these different kinds of phages on there. And if it kills, you get a zone of clearing there, then you know what organism it is because you know what phage kills that organism. And they don't mutate and start killing other organisms very often. So that's how that works. See, there's the grid for doing that. They used to have to use Mycobacterium leprae. The only way you could grow that organism was to grow it in armadillos, you know, possums on the half shell. I hate armadillos. I had a plastic grill on my little car at Mississippi State, and those blank things would jump straight up in the road and then hit that plastic grill and just pop all over. So I finally drove that car for several years with no plastic grill on the front because I replaced it twice. And so I don't like armadillos. Anyway, so they used to have to keep colonies of armadillos, and they would infect them with leprosy, and then they would isolate the leprosy from the armadillos. But it would take months or even years for them to collect enough from the armadillos to run a single experiment. A guy I went to school with at Mississippi State, we graduated from the same lab, went into studying Mycobacterium, and he's the one that came up with a method for culturing it outside of the armadillo, and that was just five, 6 years ago that it came out. So they don't have to use armadillo farms anymore. Treponema palladium, syphilis, usually you have to grow that in organisms now. Tuberculosis, you can culture in media. It's really hard to make. But you have to remember a lot of those mycobacteria are slow growers. So it may take 3 weeks to a month or so to really get any colony formation started in those cultures. Do they use that as a diagnostic test? No. They go ahead and diagnose using an indirect skin test. You get a positive for that. Do an x-ray on the chest, you start the antibiotics, and you go ahead and culture this before you start the antibiotics so that you can get a sample grown up that you can send to the CDC. I'm more afraid of this than I am HIV or a lot of diseases. I'm more afraid of this than I am Ebola. You can't help but breathe around patients. Everybody coughs. How'd you know I didn't have TB when I was up here coughing my head off a few weeks ago? Yeah, every patient coming in is going to have something. It could be TB. That one scares me more. So when you're doing your histories, when you're taking the patient history, you know, have you been exposed to TB? Might be one that you want to ask if they're coughing right in your face. I don't know if I agree with that last statement. Repeated isolation of relatively pure culture, any microorganism can mean it is an agent of disease. There's bacteria on your teeth that I can isolate in relatively pure culture every day. So I don't know if I agree with that, but I guess if I saw the same organism, rapid screening. It helps the lab technician differentiate between non-pathogens and pathogens. Lab techs are having to use instincts, and they may be wrong. I may be testing an organism that's not even a pathogen. Nurses learn how to interpret lab results to know what clinically is significant and what is a red herring. The red herrings change. Maybe a red carp. By the time you get into the medical profession and during your career as a medical professional, the red herrings are going to change. So you'll pick up on those. DNA analysis, hybridization methods, they don't use that much anymore. Probes, they do use probes a lot. They've got these great methods where you take the colony, you grab a sample of the colony, and you put it onto a plate, you put your probe over it, it lyses the cells. And then you can tell whether or not if it fluoresces, it's positive. So it's their DNA spot techniques that are really nice. So that's what it's talking about here when they're binding water. I didn't think we'd go into that much detail on this. Basically what it is the probes will bind the specific regions of DNA, so they're only going to be binding to those genes in if the genes are present. So if I pick you as a Vibrio and I know you've got this gene and no other bacteria has it, I design a probe to it. So once the probe is designed, it's either positive or it's negative. There are very few false negatives. We do DNA sequencing, and we use 16S RNA sequencers. You could do this in hospitals. It would be a little labor-intensive to do, but these 16S sequences are pretty accurate. That's how I do my gut microflora work, is I sequence the genes, the DNA, for the 16S ribosomal RNA, and then I can run it against a database and tell you what organism it is. Fluorescence is great. It's a rapid test method. I've got time. I see people packing up. I thought I was out of time. Fluorescence is great because if it fluoresces, it's there. If it doesn't, it's not. So I run the probe across it. It's attached to a fluorescent probe. If it sticks, it doesn't wash away. If it sticks, it'll fluoresce when I look at it under a fluorescent microscope and I have a positive. We used to do that with Vibrio cholera. Vibrio cholera has a really unusual flagella. So we had antibodies against the flagella that we would label with a fluorescent marker. So now, let's say I suspect this colony is Vibrio cholera. So I take that, I mix it with a little bit of this fluorescent marker that I've got, do the stain, rinse it, put it under the microscope and look at it. Only the ones that have that flagella will show fluorescence. So you can detect even very small numbers, as few as 5 bacteria will show positive with a fluorescent test. Okay. It's saying reduced to 90 minutes. If you have the right fluorescent stain for external features of the bacteria, you can do it in 30 minutes. I'm not going to test you on the fish test. It's not done much anymore. PCR. You already know what PCR is. What do you need to run a PCR test? Template DNA, nucleotides, a polymerase, heating and cooling system. Those are the 4 main things. That's what they do in the lab. The thing is with PCR is you've got to know what you're suspecting, who you're suspecting is causing the problem. Because you're having to run specific primers
perform reverse primers to detect specific bacteria.
So you only do it if you suspect it's a staph or a strep or whatever, and you have those things available. Hospitals are using PCR more and more, especially for things like MRSA, C. diff, things like that, that they run across frequently. They may not have primer sets for every weird bacteria out there. They just, it's not practical to keep that stuff on hand.
Oh, these are great biosensors.
I'm on a patent with a former physics instructor that we had here. And what we have is a laser. We built this. He built the laser. It sends a laser beam that scans an area underneath. So if I suspect a room's infected with C. diff, I go swab different areas in the room, I lay it down, I set the laser on top of it, and I hit a button. It scans, and it's looking for refractive indexes of the peptidoglycan that's unique to C. diff. It'll come back and tell me how many spores are there. Okay, it tells me whether or not C. diff was in the room when I started, and it does it in 5 minutes. So can you imagine hospitals? They're worried about lawsuits. I'm hoping they start buying this thing. Maybe I'll get to retire a little early. You know, a year or two. All right. It's already talked about serology until I'm about sick of it. You're looking for antibodies. I can look for the antigens in your bloodstream, but the problem is your antigens are going to be in such low numbers, I may not detect it. But I may be able to detect your body's reaction to the antigens and look for those antibodies. So a lot of your serology tests are going to be looking for those antibodies, not looking for the antigen. Doesn't mean you still have the disease, just that it was there at some point in time. You take your samples, if you confirm a diagnosis, so you do have to have a suspicion as to what it is. If I suspect meningitis, then I might be able to run the right serology test. It's a lot of it's agglutination testing, or not even going into it. There's a bunch of different ways of using these tests. You can use them if you're checking meat markets for illegally grinding up deer meat. You can take samples of the meat that they're selling and take some saline mixed with the meat, put it on a plate with antibodies against deer meat and or horse meat. We used to do that. And if it binds to it, it causes a cloudiness around the area, so it's positive for deer or horse or, you know, whatever. The Jewish community in New York uses this to confirm kosher. So they use a lot of these same tests. It's very sensitive. Detection's in a few minutes. Antibodies, antigens. It's real easy. Basically, you get a coloring reaction. You can combine antibodies with fluorescent markers. Let's see. You can get the agglutination test. The problem with agglutination test is they need a lot of antigen for them to work. So you can use some that are a little more sensitive. Okay. It's already talked about. All you need to know about a titer is a titer is talking about the concentration of antibody. And because the titer for one disease may be different than the titer for another, I don't care if you know what concentration it is. Just know that it's a measure of concentration. And they have a set titer for hepatitis. If you don't go over that titer, then you don't have enough antibodies to be resistant to a disease. I got a plague vaccine when I was at Mississippi State. I never won it again. But that hurt. You know, I have a long needle. It's purple. And
they were using me for experimentation. But what it is, the reason I'll have to get a booster if I ever have to go someplace where there's plague is because the titer goes down below the safe zone. So you need a booster to raise your titer back up. That's why you get booster shots of certain diseases every once in a while.
Y'all are ready to go, aren't you?
I think we're almost done.
I'll pick up with Western blotting next time.